Tonight on The Oval Office, North Melbourne's Trent Dumont opens up on his battle with mental health, and we chat D's and Blues with Jake Malksham and Dale Thomas. Let's get into it. Hello and welcome to The Oval Office. We've got two returning stars to the program this evening. Firstly, Carlton's evergreen defender, Dale Thomas. Daisy, thanks for coming back.
Thanks for having me, mate. It's great to be here.
This winning stuff goes all right.
It certainly does. Last time I was here, it was a completely different story, but a week's a long time in football, and the last few months have been no different.
We'll get to that shortly. Jake Malksham, thanks for coming back. Good to be back on the park after a few months out with that foot injury.
Yeah, it's great to be here, Mitch. Thanks for having me. It has been good to get out and have a run yesterday. First time in 3 months, so foot held up well, and I'm ready to go for this week.
All right, we'll get some more of the D's and the Blues in just a moment. But firstly, boys, the aim of this show in 2019 was to provide a platform and a voice for the players to share their experiences both on and off field. North Melbourne's Trent Dumont's come forward to share his story on mental health. The following may be distressing for some viewers, but here's a powerful message from North Melbourne's Trent Dumont.
My role with I'm Worth More is basically just to, you know, hopefully give people avenues to look after their mental health and ways to deal with their adversity. The thing that triggered my mental health battle was at the end of my first year as an AFL footballer. I was 19, I was in the off season. I had a run in with the law. I was in a cab and had an altercation with a taxi driver.
North Melbourne footballer Trent Dumont has today gone on trial, charged over the alleged robbery and assault of an Adelaide taxi driver. Dumont denies any wrongdoing, instead claiming it was the driver who assaulted him.
Having my court case dragged through the media was tough, and, you know, not too many details from the case can be revealed. So yeah, it was a really, really large emotional roller coaster. I felt like, you know, my career was going to end. I let my family down, let myself down, all the hard work I'd done to get in the position of life I was at the moment. But at the end of the day, I knew that what was said about me wasn't true. But certainly, I had some really, really big low points in my life there through that 2.5 years.
An explosive day in court for the trial of AFL rising star Trent Dumont.
Taxi security pictures played to the jury. The video shows the pair laughing and singing in the taxi. It doesn't show the cabbie being robbed or allegedly assaulted. The DPP dropped the charges, prompting a scathing attack by the judge.
In 2016, around my 21st birthday, it was the hardest time of my life, that period. That's when I was at my lowest. Things were just, you know, piling up. Sometimes I still struggle to speak about it, but I had some times, yeah, where I was really flat. Couldn't see light at the end of the tunnel. I called off all 21st celebrations. Closed myself off to everyone. In those times, I did think about potentially what it would be like if I wasn't around anymore. Would I be doing everyone a favour? But I'd never put it into action, but I definitely had thoughts about potentially suicide. Fortunately for me, got some terrific people in my life, and lots of them. My mum and my sisters and my best mate had organised a surprise 21st. That moment there, when I realised everyone that has a lot of love for me in that room, it was a big weight off my shoulders. It gave me a little bit of breathing room. I started looking into getting help. I started jumping in with club psychs. And from there, I've just slowly built up my work in the mental space. Mindfulness is probably the biggest part of my mental health strategies that I use day to day. Simply, like, it just gets you thinking about all the things that are worth living for. It gets you thinking out of your own head, out of your own little bubble. These things do happen to people. People are not alone. Reaching out and asking for help, it's probably the first step. You know, we're starting to normalise the conversation around mental health. The more people are open, or the more people can open up and normalise that, we're going to have a completely better life for everyone, a more mentally healthy community, and I think we're going to be much more productive.
We thank Trent Dumont and the North Melbourne Football Club for sharing that story, and Trent for coming forward. Of course, if you know anyone who is struggling, you can head to Beyond Blue and call 1300 224 6636, rather. Now, Dale, you've just seen that for the first time. Very tough to watch. How do you take that in, sitting there as a fellow AFL footballer?
Well, firstly, it's obviously tremendously courageous of the young fella to come forward and share his story.
Yeah.
I think the beauty of the AFL at the minute and players being able to share that they actually are struggling and come forward. You know, Wayne Swass has been a terrific ambassador for that as a past player. You see more recently Dane Beams, Jack Stevens taking time away from the game. It's amazing that as a young kid, the one thing you want to do is play football. You love it so much. And from personal experience, it can be at times the worst thing in your life for whatever reason, form, injury, scrutiny, all the things that come with being an AFL footballer. So these people and players reaching out and seeking help, you know, a problem shared is a problem halved. So to him, well done, to the wider AFL community and to the fans, especially the people who get on their social media and start trolling players. I'd advise everyone just to think before they do that, because you never know what someone is dealing with or how they're actually feeling on the inside, and it costs nothing to be nice, so I'd rather everyone activate that.
You've done some work in this space with Headspace. Can you talk us through how much that has meant to you and what you've learnt out of that?
Yeah, well, my journey sort of with Headspace was more about telling my story, sort of the battles that I went through, which in the mental sort of side of the game, and exploring that and sharing stories and understanding more about how I sort of ticked as a person. The fact that I, you know, everything I did was towards football, and when that wasn't going great, I never had really an outlet, so I just took it all on myself.
Yep.
Was blessed with great looks and amazing wit, so that was something that I used to deflect. But that was something that I used to deflect. I'd go into the club and pretend that it was, everything was all right, when times it just purely wasn't. So until I actually took the steps to reach out to somebody and share my story and share what was happening and be told that, you know, it's actually okay to not feel okay at times, and these are all normal pressures, and you know, the weight that these then lifted off your shoulders, and then your ability to then share the story, and the amount of people that reaches, and people go, you know what, I've been feeling like that, thank you so much. You know, in Trent's case there, I'm sure there'll be many people watching that, young men who will go, wow, I can certainly relate.
Jake, we just saw that for the first time you've been involved in two footy clubs. How important are footy clubs, and Trent spoke about the North Melbourne Footy Club in helping him. How important are they to deal with these type of situations and have many people around you?
Yeah, firstly, I'll echo Dale's comments there. Well said, mate. That was terrific. Unbelievably courageous by Trent. Yeah, Mitch, look, being around footy clubs, you go in every day, there's 45 players, about 25 staff.
Yeah.
Like Dale said, you can go in there and put on a front, but at times it's the best place that you can be in, because there's so many people around you. I know sometimes when I go and have an off day, someone, you know, throws a bit of mud at me, and we can have a laugh and carry on, and it just lifts you up that little bit. And some, not all workplaces are like that. Some are, but football's really good for that sort of stuff.
Absolutely. Well, just some gears now and talk more footy. Dale, on the field for the Blues, the first time the club's won three in a row for the first time since 2016. How was that feeling walking off the park at the MCG on Saturday?
Yeah, it was really exciting, obviously. Probably our best performance over the past couple of months. I think we won every quarter, which was fantastic. Led from the front again by our young emerging superstar, Paddy Cripps. But the way the boys are playing at the minute, the confidence we have as a group, and the performances we're putting in, week out, which is the most pleasing thing. I guess when you speak about younger groups and emerging groups, there's the fluctuations in form. Thankfully for us, that hasn't happened since Teague has taken over, and hopefully we can continue to build.
You've bounded in here tonight like you've got another spring in your step. Does it feel like footy's back again and you're enjoying and having fun again?
Yeah, most definitely. I think, you know, winning obviously helps that mood around the place, but as an older player, you know, the most pleasing thing for us is that everyone across the board is playing their role, but especially us older blokes are still having an impact on the game. I think, you know, Cade Simpson, Mark Murphy, Ed Curno on the weekend, the older blokes, Chuck myself in there as well.
We're, couldn't miss you.
Yeah, well, I've got to give myself a little pump up.
Fountain of youth today, you said?
Fountain of youth, been bathing in it daily. But no, just finding that love for it and the form, and then the performances coming off the back of it, it's been brilliant, and been loving my time down there.
Now, I heard Brendan Bolton speaking at the start of the year talking about the fourth year players. It was time for them to step up, your Harry Mackays, Charlie Curno, these type of guys. Can you talk us through one of the guys taken later in the draft that's really found his feet in the last few weeks in Jack Silvani?
Yeah, Jack's been terrific. He got dropped a couple of weeks under David Teague when he first came in, and I know that he was certainly very upset about that, but the beauty of an emerging club is that there's going to be competition for spots, and Jack unfortunately fell out of the side that week. His response, I think he went back in the VFL, had 30-odd touches, 3 goals and 15 tackles, and from there he's brought that in. His pressure, his ability to either win half or bring other people into the game. He's a smart footballer. We all know the pedigree of the family, but his effort and want to be in that side has been the highlight, and he's been leading the way down there and showing the younger boys around him about how to go about it.
Now, Fountain of Youth, out of contract at the end of this season. We have to ask, where is it sitting at the moment? And conversations begun talking about 2020?
I certainly know that my manager is going in, I think, tomorrow or the next day. So okay. I waited till I played a pretty good game before I start to wind these chats up. And now hopefully I can go around again. As I said, I'm really enjoying it. You know, as we see when you get a bit older, the discussion is whether to go on or not. But I think it should be form-based. And, you know, without pumping myself up too much, I think my form's certainly there to carry on again.
How many phone calls are you putting in each day to Paul Connors?
Well, he's just gone back from Thailand, so they were international, so there's a few. Don't worry about that.
All right, Jake, we'll talk to the Ds now. Just firstly, your first game back on the weekend, how'd you pull up and good to be back on the park?
Yeah, it was good. I pulled up fine. So fractured foot, 12 weeks out, not ideal, but got through the game really well, played about three quarters and... yeah, hopefully the coach gives me the nod this week.
Now, it wasn't great news for the AFL side on the weekend, falling to St Kilda. Max Gawn, pretty matter-of-fact as always. These are his comments after the game as the Demons stuck in 17th spot.
Oh, we're a long way off. A really good basic football team, so getting the basics right. Our fundamentals are deplorable at times, and almost the last 5-6 weeks, actually could almost say the whole year maybe, but GWS, we've been in games up until the last quarter, and we get blown away. We're just not even close in the end. It's 20 points. It's not the brand that we've tried to build over many years, going back 3 or 4 years. So it's really disappointing we can't finish off games, but we were fundamentally bad probably the whole game.
We love Max. He talks and speaks his mind. Can you talk us through and where you sit with those comments?
Yeah, I think he's just being honest, Max, and people that watch the game and have watched us throughout the year would echo those comments.
Yeah.
We haven't been a good basic football team. Our fundamentals have dropped away. It started at the start of the season. We were good in some areas, and then as we've gradually gotten worse throughout the year, the fundamentals have dropped away, like he said. So we've just got to keep working hard on the track. We've got a month left to give our fans something to enjoy after the season, and we get ready for, you know, those four games and beyond.
What are you trying to get out of those last 4 weeks? Because, as you said, the finals are out of the question now. Hopefully you're back this week. What are some of the goals, or what are you trying to tick off in that last month?
Well, if we look at the last month, apart from the weekend, or well, we're in the game on the weekend as well, but before that we're playing some pretty good footy and we should have won probably the two previous games. So if we can come back this week, implement the same thing, get the skill level up a little bit and play with a little bit more spirit, then we can win a few games and finish the year strongly.
Now, sorry, Dale.
So I was just going to say, obviously being in that position before, the ability to play party pooper, you've got Richmond on the weekend.
That's
surely
right,
yeah. The shackles are sort of off in some regard now.
Yeah, so in many ways we can affect what goes on in the finals, even though we won't be playing in them. So I know last year when we were going into the series, there was a lot of teams that were trying to come at us and derail us, and we were able to withstand that. So hopefully we can just play good footy. At the end of the day, if you change your finals around a little bit, then so be it. But it's about what we're doing internally and try and win a few games.
All right, all eyes on the Ds for the rest of this season. Stick with us here on the Oval Office. We've got a bone to pick with Dale Thomas and we'll chat more Ds with Jake Malksham. Welcome back to the Oval Office. We thank Trent Dumont again for opening up and telling his story. You can catch up on all of that on our social channels, thanks to Tobin Brothers Funerals, celebrating lives. Time now to get into the dig, all thanks to Dial Before You Dig. Daisy, you've been thinking about this one all day. You played against plenty of your former teammates. Talk us through this one, Grant Birchall and Luke Hodge on the weekend.
Yeah, very interesting stuff this. They were obviously a lot closer than me with my former teammates. Not sure how the umpire adjudicated this, but that wasn't holding the ball free kick to Hodgie. It was a free kick to Grant Birchall. So just a little cheeky, I'm not sure if we're allowed to say sack tap, but I think that's what it was.
What would happen if Dale Thomas did that to Jake Malksham this weekend? Or in future weeks?
I'd probably ask him on a date first.
Now, Jake, we saw a shattering story today. Dale Morris doing his ACL again. This is a dig for human nature for having this knee go again. Talk us through this one, and it's a bit tough pill for these teammates to swallow.
Yeah, it's a shame for Dale. He's been a really good player for the Bulldogs over a long time. I actually trained there as an AIS kid about 11, 12 years ago. And he was a fantastic player, Dale, and great person as well. And You know, it was only a couple of days ago Luke was talking about him potentially playing on next year if he got things going. So I hope that he can get a quick recovery in with maybe a little LARS surgery and maybe have another year of footy in him. That'd be great.
Do you remember Dale Morris being as good as a bloke then as he is now?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, he was a local Essendon boy out where I was from. He was a Duda Stars boy and... yeah, he was just a terrific bloke. I don't think there'd be a person at the Bulldogs that'd have a bad word to say about him.
Absolutely. Now, the host of this show rarely gets a dig. We usually leave it to the players, but I've been trying to get something off my chest for 6 years. Dale, and it refers to you back at the Sydney airport in 2013. Talk us through this. This is an interview for the Footy Show when you were leaving the Pies. I think we announced your move to the Blues live on the Footy Show in this chat.
Yeah, I was. I'd been up. It was after I'd injured my ankle in a VFL return game, and I went to Sydney for a couple of days. I had been granted 4 or 5 days leave by the club, and I decided whilst I was up there that Fiji was looking nice. The weather in Sydney wasn't as great as I'd hoped, and I got to the international departures, and I think my mum knew, and that was about it. I hadn't actually told the footy club at that point, so sorry, Bucks, if you're listening, you weren't first to know. But much to my surprise, yeah, unless my mum snitched on me, you've got better sources than I do because you were at the departures lounge. I wasn't a big enough name to get Damien Barrett there. And you were there.
As you said in the tweet, the Essendon stuff was going on at the time, so they sent me up.
Yeah, the Essendon stuff was going on and I got the work experience, kid, so you've turned out all right, mate.
All right, thanks, mate. Thanks for joining the show. I was a bit worried when I saw your name. I thought you might not have rocked up. That was all thanks to Dole Before You Dig. Be safe every time. Search Dole Before You Dig online. Now, time to get to our diamond in the rough. All thanks to the Australian Diamond Company with you every step of the way. Daisy, Heath Shaw played his 300th game on the weekend and it was one of his fans in the crowd just giving it to the Port fans.
Yeah, fans or family member. We haven't yet figured out which one it was, but you see there, late in the game, I think there's only a point the difference, and the one bloke amongst the cast of thousands of Port fans, it's a very brave man, because for anyone who's been over to Port Adelaide, I do love their fans. They're very passionate, but they could be very, very scary as well.
How important are the interstate fans when they're on the road?
Oh, huge. I love playing at Adelaide Oval, though. As Dale said, Port Adelaide fans, they get pretty up and about when you're over there, and especially if they're winning, and more so even if they're losing, they love giving a bit of lip over the boundary line, which is always fun.
All right, thanks for that. That was the diamond in the rough. All thanks to the Australian Diamond Company. Book an appointment at adc.com.au. Up after the break, we chat about one of the Tigers' stars in the forward line. You're with the Oval Office. Welcome back to the Oval Office. We've sent Jake Melksham over to the Repco Authorised Service Replay screen. Book your next car service at repcoservice.com. Jake, a big assignment this week for the Ds up against Tom Lynch. He's hit pretty good form at the moment with 5 goals on the weekend.
Yeah, just in time for us. There was a fair bit of Wayne Carey about Tom on the weekend with the weather footy that he played. If you have a look at the edits here, his forward craft's right on top of his game at the moment, but his running power, forward of the footy, and also his ability to score goals, forward to centre, has been unreal. This one is a beauty. But, yeah, hopefully we can get Steve May back this week to take on his old co-captain and take it up to him.
Obviously, a lot of talk with him coming over was how him and Riewoldt would function in the forward line. Riewoldt's been out for a large portion, but in this game in particular, what did you make of the way those two went about it?
Yeah, I thought the cohesion they had was really good. I guess at times, you know, Jack will have his nights where he's a bit more quiet and Tom will have the same, but on this night, it was time for Tom to get a bit of a lick of the ice cream, and I'm sure with their team first footy that they play, it'll turn around soon for Jack.
How keen was Stephen Mabey to come up against his old former co-captain at the Suns?
Yeah, super keen. I think they played a fair bit of footy on each other in pre-season games, and Steve tells me that he always used to get the nod on him. So if he can make it back this week, that'd be a huge advantage for us.
All right, Daz, you've got the Tigers in a few weeks. Jacob Wietering's in probably arguably career best form at the moment as well. He'd probably get the assignment on Tom Lynch.
Yeah, he probably would at this stage, him or Liam Jones. But Jacob Wietering, we spoke at the top about those fourth-year players being Silvani, Curnow, Wietering, also a former number one pick. His ability to grow as the season's gone, probably similar to our form, he's really improved over the year, but his ability to win the ball, intercept marking and just beat his opponent. He's played on some pretty big lads. You see him here on Big Jerker Jenkins, who's a big lump of a lad, and he's still only 20-odd himself. The beard probably gives him away. It's not great. he's in ripping form and someone I'm really enjoying playing with down there.
All right, it'd be remiss of us not to talk about the match review today. Dale, you've got your own issues to get to, but firstly, Mark Witsars was the big story. Fined $1,000 for staging in this incident against Sydney. Jake, what would happen if one of your D's teammates rolled this out?
Yeah, we actually had a fine system every Monday, so that was today. And if I was down the Cattery, I'd be throwing another fine at Blixars there for that one. It was quite amusing.
Daisy, you've racked up a lazy 12 grand this year at the match review. You got another issue on your hands this week for a little whack, love tap on Lockie Murphy. Where's that sitting?
Well, I think we've got until 11 o'clock tomorrow to decide whether or not we go and challenge. So hopefully the legal team are having a look at it, because generally, if you've done something wrong, you come off the ground and you're a touch nervous. And I didn't think I'd actually... Yeah. I thought I'd got through a week, but unfortunately, Brad Lloyd pulled me in the office today and I got the word that I was up for another $3,000 donation if I choose to take the guilty plea. So...
That hurts the footy trip fund?
Yeah, well, that will probably mean no footy trip. Gil McLaughlin's footy trip will be better than mine, that's for sure.
All right, stick with us here on the Oval Office. We've got the McCafe next. We're over to the Scramble. Thanks for sticking with the Oval Office. Jake Melks has been dominating at the Repco Authorised Service Centre replay screen. Book your next car service at repcoservice.com. We're here at the McCafe now. Dale, firstly, celebrators. Who's the best at the Blues?
Probably Charlie Curnow gives it a fair bit, but I've snuck forward a couple of times and for an old boy, still probably give it way too much. So, but Charlie loves it.
Jake?
It'd have to be either Alex Neil Bullen or Max Gorn. He likes the cameras on him.
All right, toughest opponent this year. Have you got one across the column?
It'd have to be round two. I was on Kolodziejczyk, the human glove.
Yep.
It didn't let me out of his sights and just manhandled me for a good half a footy. That was fun.
And Dale, for McCafe, Australia's finest barista-made coffee ever, who is the best first-year player you've seen? I reckon you might have an easy answer on this one.
It certainly is. Sam Walsh is probably the best first-year I've seen come into the system. The way he goes about it, what he's producing on the weekend, so consistent at such a young age, has been amazing. And no surprise that he's the favourite for the Rising Star.
I'm pretty sure he's about to win that. Now, boys, you don't go away empty-handed here on the Oval Office. Some great gear, all thanks to Hip Pocket Workwear and Safety. They have you covered in FXD Function by Design. For joining us tonight, you also get a Macca's $50 McCafe voucher. Heading to taste their finest barista-made coffee ever. Keep things cool with the Dometic CI42 Icebox. Dometic Mobile, living made easy. Danger loves those on the real adventures. And footy's back, so rediscover Melbourne's Parkview from $159 for two people. Now, boys, you've already been back twice here on the Oval Office. We're going to see you back with Sam McClure.
Yeah, if he'll have us back, that's for sure. I'll be here.
Yeah, definitely. If we get them little prize packs there, I'll come back. No chance.
We'll see if we can go third time lucky. Thanks for joining us. Don't forget you can download the SEN app to catch up on all the things. See you next week with Sam McClure.